Thank you as well.
Vestigial mode of time measurement based on solar cycles. It's not applicable. I didn't get you anything.
So that's why River is terrible to invite to your birthday parties, because she doesn't believe in birthdays in the first place. And further, since we're all time traveling all the time, like right now in this room together, we're all on board this temporal ship. I thought it would be a good question to ask, like, what do we mean when we say we're time traveling? The problem with that is we have to first figure out what exactly we mean by time. And a lot of people try to answer that question. Starting with, St. Augustine, who in the 4th century said this quote, which is the first quote on your agenda, I think. What then is time? If no one asks me, I know what it is. If I wish to explain it to him who asks, I do not know. So that quote is actually practically a cliche in time theory books right now. Everybody quotes that at some point. So I figured we could do a few things. We could ask Google, what's time? And we find out what time it is. And we find out that there's a magazine called Time. And if we look at images, we find that there are a bunch of pictures of clocks, none of which are actually time in and of themselves. Okay. So not very helpful. So then I did what I usually do, which is I go to the OED. We should always ask the OED. And where is it? Time. Now. View full entry. Time. Now. An extent of time. Considered as a period. A finite extent or stretch of continued existence. Now, you don't have to read through all of this because I've already read through it for you. All of it. But this is not a very helpful definition. In fact, it goes on nearly ad nauseum. If you watch my little scroll button over here, you'll see I'm only a tenth of the way through. Let's go a little faster. It's almost like the OED's definition of time is meant to demonstrate what it feels like to spend time or to waste time. If you Wikipedia time, you actually get some much better answers. One is the same tautology we keep seeing. The circular definition of time is what clocks measure. And the other one is my favorite definition, which is really beautifully simple. It's time is what keeps everything from happening at once. That's perfect. So what is time? Well, what would a world be like without time? well, everything would happen at once. Therefore, time is the thing that keeps everything from happening at once. That's the one I'd put in my pocket if I had to settle on one. If you ask an astronomer what time is, you'll get an answer along the lines of time is the measure of the increase of entropy in the universe. That is, as the universe tends towards greater entropy or greater disorder, so too has time increased. This is the definition that we have for Heinlein's the heat death of the universe, which we read for last week, in which the closed system of the house becomes a metaphor. Carl Sagan, who I will repeatedly bring up because he's my favorite, would say that to be is to voyage through time, which is definitely true. He would also say that telescopes are time machines, so every time you look through a telescope, you are literally looking backwards in time. And then finally, if you ask a physicist, specifically this guy, Tom O'Brien. Tom O'Brien is the physicist in charge of NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, also known as the world's most accurate atomic clock. Surely Tom has an answer for what time is. Surely he knows, after all, it's his job. So let's ask him.
Here's the first question. What is time?
My own personal opinion is that time is a human construct.
What? That is absolutely no way helpful at all. He runs the world's most accurate atomic clock, and he just says it's a human construct. Really, if we want anyone to give us an actual answer as to what time is, they only exist in fiction, and it's Doctor Who.
People assume that time is a strict progression of cause to effect, but actually, from a non-linear, non-subjective viewpoint, it's more like a big ball of wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff.
In short, time is a metaphor, it's a human construct. To quote Anthony Aveni, who is the second quote on your sheet, time gets spent, wasted, killed, kept, and lost. We have leisure time, quality time, good times, bad times, hard times, even hot times. When we say tempus fugit, we may not realize that the Romans, who coined that phrase, were equating time with the ether. Time not only blows by us like a Roman wind, it also flies like a bird, walks like an old man with a scythe, flows like a river, and gets out of joint, like our bones. In sports teams, we can get out of it, time out, or back into it, time in. In science fiction, we travel through it in many warps. Punctual businessmen are on it. Old people are beyond it. Prodigies are before or ahead of it. And great comics and musicians are said to have a marvelous sense of it. Time, at its core, is nebulously and metaphorically ill-defined in just the sort of way that makes it the perfect subject for science fiction. People love time traveling. It satisfies wish fulfillment. It allows us to imagine alternative histories. It allows an escape from fear of the inevitable, that is death. It even allows us to out-romance the most romantic of romances by extending them across infinite time. Sci-fi is full of time travel, highbrow and lowbrow, from Primer to Bill and Ted's Excellent Adventure, both of which I highly recommend. As I've been said before, earlier in this course, time travel stories are essentially like a rite of passage. Every sci-fi author has to write at some point their attempt at the time travel medium, at this wibbly-wobbly, timey-wimey stuff. So today I had you guys read two completely different types of time travel stories. One is the Gernsback Continuum, the other was All You Zombies, Heinlein and Gibson, right? But I would actually argue every book we've read in this course is in some way related to time travel. It's unavoidable. You can't really have narrative without some sort of assumption about time. Granted, there are more or less interesting forms of time travel. But even like Galatea 2.2, which we read 2 weeks ago, though not explicitly about time travel, depends hugely on time travel, right? The entire plot is based on bouncing between two interweaving distinct periods of time. One in which Rick is in his 20s and in a relationship with C, and the other when he is in his 30s teaching Helen. The two time frames superimpose on one another via the time traveling power of memory, such that events, symbols, themes, etc., resonate in the remembrance of things past. Although neither time narrative or timeline would be complete without its counterpart. Thus, we can say the entire narrative of Galaxy 2.2 depends on time travel through memory. But let's talk about, you know, a real sci-fi part of time travel, like the time machine, which is what we started this course with. We don't make it one page. I mean, I think it's page two, maybe even on the first page, depending on your edition, before H.G. Wells goes off on this marvelous infodump on how time travel works, right? Time travel, it is the fourth dimension. It's essentially a geometry lesson. In a nutshell, Wells' theory of time is super linear. I think you guys all sort of know this, maybe, but you know, he outlines the different spatial dimensions, and then I don't think I can go through all of it. And then gives us time, which is all three dimensions, then moving on a perpendicular axis. And we learn some kind of interesting things, right? There is an infinite amount of points in a line, an infinite amount of lines in a plane, an infinite amount of planes in a cube, and an infinite amount of cubes moving through the fourth dimension of time. Or if you add duration to any of the previous, the lower dimensions, like if you add duration to a point extended over time becomes a line extended over time becomes a plane becomes a cube, etc. And we get all this for essentially him establishing a reality effect. It's like a super rational info dump that allows us like to suspend our disbelief and then enjoy this like story traveling to the future. Of course, H.G. Wells ignores the problem that if he goes well into the future on a temporal axis, when he comes back, he would probably crash into himself. But if you want to see a version of time travel that really solves that paradox, there's a Futurama episode. Let's see, I had to pull it up somewhere else. There it is. In which they invent a time machine that is remarkably inspired by H.G. Wells. And they solve this paradox, and you should totally watch this. It's called
The Late Philip J. Fry.
The Late Philip J. Fry. Yes. You should also watch that in Futurama. Okay, so just keep in mind this geometrical time travel, because because the next book we read, Connecticut, Yankee, and King Arthur's Court, Mark Twain couldn't have cared less about providing some sort of info dump to explain how the time travel works. Hank, the Yank, is literally hit so hard upside the head that he is knocked back into the 6th century. I think we mentioned very briefly in class that Bud Foote's research on the Connecticut Yankee and King Arthur's Court. But since this class is explicitly about time travel, I'm gonna go more into it because I think it's incredibly interesting. This story is the first time in Western literature where time travel to the past occurs. To say that again, in 1991, a professor of English at Georgia Tech named Bud Foote read a ton of Western literature and could find no instance before Mark Twain's Connecticut Yankee in which somebody wrote a narrative which somebody traveled to the past and tried to change anything. That's really weird. Nobody thought of time travel to the past before 1889, and perhaps the 5 years before when Mark Twain was working on drafting the Connecticut Yankee. Nobody ever imagined a story in which the Trojans just burned down that darn horse. Nobody ever imagined Dante and Beatrice maybe not dying or something like that, some sort of romance between Dante and Beatrice. Juliet could have gone for a do-over, and that could make a very interesting story. Or a story about what might have happened if the Library of Alexandria hadn't burned down, somebody had saved that Library of Alexandria, which might have perhaps involved saving a narrative in which time travel to the past did occur, but we wouldn't know because the Library of Alexandria burned down. Surely, time travel to the past and trying to change things is the stuff of nostalgia, of Odysseus. somebody would have thought of this. No, no one thought of this. It never, ever happened. To quote Budfoot, philosophers, ancient and medieval, pagan and Christian, all agree that even God cannot change the past. Even Jesus, though he was able to raise the dead, apparently could not spare Lazarus the agony of having died. Nor does the idea seem to have even occurred to him. While God could, without violating his own rules, create unicorns and centaurs, cause someone to sleep for 100 years, or even temporarily and locally reverse entropy by raising someone from the dead, changing the past would seem to affect, to shape, the very fabric of the universe. And yet, it seems to us that they, those pre-industrialists, they must have thought of it. They must have done it homes. If only I could go back and change that one thing. But nobody seems to have thought that way, at least from the evidence in the literature. This is to propose a change in the quality of human consciousness pre-industrialization. Travel to the past, and the change of that past seems to have been the sort of mega foolishness which nobody could think of, or if they could not take with sufficient seriousness to make a fiction out of it. Until the Connecticut Yankee. Mark Twain, Parker, 1889. This epiphany, for me at least, makes the Connecticut Yankee all the more remarkable because it has, for the first time, imagined something that has never before been imagined. No one here turns the question back on its audience. It makes the reader ask him or herself, just what else haven't we thought of? What sort of obvious things exist beyond the bounds of our collective imaginations? What would be obvious to a future audience that is absolutely invisible to us? Sci-fi is great at asking questions like that. Does anybody want to know why Mark Twain? Why 1889? According to Budfoot? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, so I mean, you get it better just to read the conclusion of his book, but in a nutshell, he argues, first of all, that Twain thinks about time spatially and always has his entire life. And he has a few examples of Twain doing this. Two, he argues that there's already this tendency to refer to the old world and the new world, the old world being Europe, and the new world being America. So this spatial-temporal thinking was already in line. Three is there's a whole bunch of artwork. Like, for example, Thomas Cole's Voyage of Life, a super famous epic painting from the mid-19th century, in which the human life is imagined as a voyage on a river, right? So, I'm having trouble zooming in. But you can sort of see there's this little child emerging on this boat from this Freudian cave and thus begins life. And to just quickly run through it, here is youth, where everything is so exciting and all potentials are possible and they exist in the future as castles in the sky. Semiotic phantoms, perhaps. We can look at that again later. Manhood, which doesn't look very fun. But if you make it through manhood, then you get to go to old age, which looks decidedly better. Yes. So time has been thought of as a river forever. And that's a good metaphor, right? You flow through time, you kind of like, can't really go against time any more than you can like swim upstream. It's pretty futile. It's really hard. Anybody ever tried to swim up river? Anything with a significant current is tough. That's why Mark Twain is. Mark Twain is the first major author to also be a steamboat operator. This is a pretty weird argument, right? It's kind of great though. You know, he was a steamboat operator. So he was part of the first generation for which the river of time, which he would have thought about immensely, going down the Mississippi, up the Mississippi, over and over again. This is the stuff of Huckleberry Finn, right? Turns into, at least for him, for the first time, he can go upstream. He can go back. So that's Budfoot's argument. I don't know if you guys are convinced, but I was pretty convinced. All right, let's table Mark Twain. Go on to all you Mondays, because I am running out of time. Heinlein's story is the classic example of the grandfather paradox. There are some examples before Heinlein, but Heinlein's is probably the most famous. There are many, many, many time travel stories that riff on the grandfather paradox. Doctor Who does it, and of course, Back to the Future does it. This paradox makes you think in a loop. Right? This is the bartender's ring, Ouroboros, the snake that eats its own tail. And it's a story about solipsism. Any philosophers in here know what solipsism is? I know some of you do from my sections. Don't worry. I can't be sure that anything exists except for myself. I was sort of going to draw out really quickly the timeline of the story, but I think it might be a little bit too much time. I can do it really quick. In a nutshell, if this is regular time, right? Past, future, this is like normal, Wellesian time. We have, it's 1974, which is when they meet in the bar. The time traveler and the, what?
That's a five.
Oh, yeah, he's that. Thank you. And then the time travel bartender abducts himself back to, actually, let me just do this, 1974 is just my favorite because Heinlein refers to it just very briefly as a nasty period. Says nothing more about it. 1985, and then 1993, which I hope is not. So let's do it. He picks himself up, takes him back to 1963, where he leaves himself to commit an autogenetic act. And then he jumps forward to 1964 to abduct himself from the hospital where he has just been born. And then he runs back to 1945 to pull a Dumbledore and leave himself on the steps of some orphanage. Then jumping back to 1963 to pick up himself, his own post-coital self, I suppose. And then he takes himself back to, then he goes to 1985 with himself, where he drops himself off to begin training his younger self. Then he goes back, and I believe he goes back to 1970, sells the bar, and then goes to 1993, where he then, I suppose, retires. We don't really know what he does at the end. So what we see here is the Ouroboros, the like simple, you know, circle, which we kind of expected, isn't effective enough for an error plot. So Heinlein essentially twists it a bunch of times, but it's still the same idea. It's just more like a resulting knot. Still works. Makes for a sneaky, tortuous story. It's more fun. Adds more narrative suspense. So this sort of story rewards second readings. In fact, you have to read it a second time, because if you the first time through, there's no way you can catch any double entendres. Typical of Heinlein, the humor is thick. He lays it on very thick. And this is also typical of most time travel stories in which the grandfather paradox is allowed, because the incest taboo, which is one of the like central taboos of Western culture, is really funny to make funny. It's the basis of, you know, let's see. Marty.
Do you mind if I sit here?
No.
Fine.
No.
Good.
Fine. Good.
That's a big bruise you have there.
So, I mean, like, humor that film was based on this sort of scene happening over and over again. And in Heinlein, it's the same thing. On page one, we get He was the lad I was here to recruit, the bartender says. He was my boy. I gave him my best barkeep smile. Means simultaneously, of course, narratively, the barkeep is just saying, I'm here to recruit this guy. But also he's saying, that's my boy, isn't genetically my child, and I gave him my best barkeep smile. Means I smiled at him, but also I genetically gave him that smile. And suddenly, like, these other lines get, like, really funny. Like, nobody in my family ever marries. All bastards. Bastardizing himself, okay? Don't try to top me, you're married, he said, pointing to my ring. Screw yourself, in Heinlein, takes on a completely different meaning. It is, in fact, a compliment, in fact, of the highest regard. It means commit the autopoetic act of self-creation that allows you to step outside the timeline prison and into a world of godlike control over time. Screw yourself. Heinlein knows that's funny, and he's playing with that. It gives new meaning to Woody Allen's famous quip that masturbation is sex with someone you truly love. It's a shock, Heinlein says, to have it proved to you that you can't resist seducing yourself. There are a lot of crimes you can forgive yourself in Heinlein when you're both the perpetrator and the victim. So what's at play with solipsism, and why does he call the story All You Zombies? I think this is because if you think of the time traveler, any time traveler, as an Ouroboros, a snake that eats its own tail, that means that everyone else who is not a snake that eats its own tail is just a snake that doesn't eat its own tail. This is a snake. That's a regular person. So to extend this further, if you're a four-dimensional thing or a person that, or a thing that can perceive four dimensions, and you're looking at a thing that is stuck in three dimensions and doesn't see it, what does it look like? Well, it looks like a big object, geometric object, and at one end is a like baby. This is a baby. That's the best I could do. And on the other end, there's this baby, and it grows up over the course of this timeline. And the other end, it's a tombstone, right? We essentially look like giant snakes, like worms. We get another great visualization of this in, here's another, this is an example of what space might look like when perceived in a higher dimension. This is Matthew McConaughey surrounded by tesseracts. Where's Donnie Darko? Donnie Darko can see into the future, and he sees it as essentially a snake worm-like object receding out of the center of gravity.
I'm looking at beer.
So in the end, the barkeep goes to bed, lamenting his loneliness, the one time traveler among all the zombies, and he wonders like where the rest of us come from. If we're not auto-poetically created, if we're not like, if we didn't self-create at some point, then how are we even here? And this is where a lot of speculation can go in, and I hope one of my students wrote a paper on this, maybe they did. We're talking about this in section. We're thinking maybe there's some sort of time-traveling atom that goes back and is the source for all of us. But who knows? Again, what Bloodfoot realized about time travel, that even God wouldn't do it until the Connecticut Yankee, is true here, the time travel essentially does become my god, and that's why the narrative has to be this sci-fi thing. There's one other story I was going to assign for today called A Needle in a Time Stack by Robert Silverberg, and I ended up not doing it, but you should read it. It's about a guy who also is essentially like a time police kind of person, except he goes back in time over and over and over and over again to make the most mundane changes to his own life in order to eventually become his most perfect self. It's like a you that never ever made a mistake or a bad decision, constantly went back and corrected everything. It's interesting. Stranger yet, is we don't need time travel to potentially become our own grandpas. We'll play the song, but first, can anybody just see this article? How a man's unborn twin fathered his child? That's not quite becoming your own grandpa, but things get strange. And then there is, yes, of course, the song that's directly referenced in the short story, I'm a Grandpa, which will hopefully come to us without any advertising. Oh, no. Let's see here.
Those are all the same person,
huh? So this is just an example of how, by the semantic slippage of the words we use to define familial relations, one can become one's own grandpa. Here we go.
Many, many years ago, when I was 23, I was married to a widow who was pretty as can be. This widow had a grown-up daughter who had hair of red. My father fell in love with her, and soon they too were wed. This made my dad my son-in-law and really changed my life. Now my daughter was my mother, 'cause she was my father's wife. And to complicate the matter, even though it brought me joy, I soon became the father of a bouncing baby boy. My little baby then became a brother-in-law to Dad, and so became my uncle, though it made me very sad. For if he were my uncle, then that also made him brother of the widow's grown-up daughter, who was, of course, my stepmother. Father's wife then had a son who kept them on the run, and he became my grandchild, for he was my daughter's son. My wife is now my mother's mother, and it makes me blue, because although she is my wife, she's my grandmother too. Now, if my wife is my grandmother, then I'm her grandchild. Yeah. And every time I think of it, nearly drives me wild. 'Cause now I have become the strangest case you ever saw. As husband of my grandmother, I am my own grandpa. Oh, I'm my own grandpa.
I watched that like 5 or 6 times now, and it's still don't quite get it, but it works, I swear. All right, I'm gonna channel Stephen Burt. I think we should all stand up and sit down. There's a lot of studies that say this is very, very good for maintaining attention. Come on, just stand up. All right. Let's switch gears to the Gernsback Continuum, which I hope you enjoy. This is a very different type of time travel story. This is one in which the past erupts into the present and haunts the narrator. It's a time travel story about entelechy, that is, the realization of one potential among many other possible potentials. And it's also about the collapse of the present into a single wavelength. Gibson was originally going to call this story The Airstream Futuropolis, The Tomorrow That Never Was, but then he changed it to the Gernsback Continuum to emphasize the genre-wide critique he was making through the story. The narrator is haunted by the dream of what is more or less the vision of the 1939 World's Fair, which was deemed your world of tomorrow. This is the 1939 World's Fair theme song. There's a lot of music today.
Lack of trying.
This was a huge World's Fair, and I think he's alluding to it. He's definitely alluding to the architectural aesthetic of the World's Fair, and a lot of Art Deco stuff. I'll show you a few more pictures of. But like the World's Fair, the world of the future today had exhibitions in it that were like the Fun Fair Futurama, which is also the inspiration for Matt Groening's Futurama, and also what Carl Sagan saw that said apparently inspired him to a life of science. In it was a giant exhibition of the future city of tomorrow that you would fly over as if you were on a low-flying airplane. This city was air-conditioned, streamlined, chrome. It was populated with cars. Everybody had cars. Fantastic freedom and mobility. And that's this air supreme Futuropolis that Gibson is talking about. Bell Geddes, airships. These are the best images I could find. These are the airships he's referring to. There we go, an airship over New York, 2009. That's fitting with this story. Yalta Downs, his fictional historian, is more or less obsessed with the 1930s, 1940s American Art Deco future chic. And then Gibson introduces this amazing term, the semiotic phantom. I love this term. Can anybody define the semiotic phantom? It's kind of weird. The semiotic phantom is a common symptom of someone who studies too much microhistory. The historian begins to lose grip of the lines between defining what was, what is, and what could have been. The historian begins to feel the opposite of nostalgia, a longing not for the past, but for a past future. Gibson calls this fragments of the mass dream, bits of deep cultural imagery that have split off and taken a life of their own, like the Jules Verne airships that those old Kansas farmers were always in. When a fictional imagination of the past, when a fictional past imagination of the future persists in manifesting itself in the present, as with the 1939 Gernsbackian World's Fair, the semiotic ghost ruptures the boundary between past and present, and between present and parallel, demanding a reckoning between the possible future and the realized present. Did you guys get that? It's a little confusing, but it's awesome. And it's also, there's some question as to whether or not this sort of hallucination is a sci-fi thing or kind of real. You study like too much 1930 stuff or 1880 stuff, you start seeing like Victorian things all around you, right? Or modernist things all around you. You realize how permeated everything is with the remnants of this past culture. There's a quote on your sheet from Philip K. Dick, which is very interested in this idea. History, thus examined, abhors a line. Events may be ordered one after other, but the past perpetually erupts into the present. The future folds back onto the past, and the parallel, unrealized potential universes perpetually pressure the present with the constricting squeeze of if only, if only. Of course, Gibson is also making a critique of what Golden Age sci-fi imagined as a genre versus what the 1980s sci-fi imagined. Golden Age sci-fi is represented by Gibson's allusion to Tom Swift. Has anybody heard of Tom Swift? Yeah, all right. Can you tell me who Tom Swift is?
He's a boy inventor that was the subject of a long series of popular novels, and he sort of goes through with his buddies and invents things to solve all those problems.
Good. Excellent. My dad has like a whole shelf of Tom Swift from when he was a kid. I even read a few Tom Swifts. Tom Swift is an endless series of children's books whose technophilic plots sold like crazy. There were tons and tons of these books, like over 100. I read through them until I realized they are essentially the same plot over and over again, which was apparent to me even as like an 8-year-old. That's about their death. Tom Swift is the ultimate handyman. He is the Edison inventor of all things to save the day. He is the crystallization of pre-World War II technophilic deus ex machina, God from machine spirit that pervaded American culture. He is exceedingly arrogant. He often has a military cut. Back to Tom Swift and his flying lab. I was just reading that. This is ironic. Apparently, one book, Thomas A. Swift and his electric, was about Thomas A. Swift and his electric rifle. Tom Swift and his electric rifle, which became an acronym.
Thomas A. Swift's electric rifle,
which is tremendously ironic. That's the etymology. So to say on Wikipedia, I like it too much to argue with it. So whereas Delta Downs obsesses with this 1930s technophilic aesthetic, she essentially becomes a stand-in for the modern-day classic sci-fi fan. That is, she is an out-of-touch loony. As Gibson puts it, in retrospect, I see her walking under a floating neon sign that flashes, "This way lies madness," in huge sans-serif capitals. She also represents a type of sci-fi fandom that fetishizes this particular moment in sci-fi without seeing any irony in it whatsoever, without seeing the dread totalitarian eugenic implications of where this sci-fi leads and the nightmare this sci-fi celebrates. The story is full of illusions. His diet pill, for example, he takes a diet pill and starts to drive, already driving as an escape. Seems kind of 1939 World's Fair to me. But the diet pill, the amphetamine, or the potential of it being an amphetamine hallucination, seems an homage to Philip K. Dick. The offhand reference to muties, right, mutations, is a Heinlein term, right out of Heinlein's Orphans of the Sky. The colossal Tucson that never was. Let's make this bigger. Bigger and pixelated, but bigger nonetheless. Seems as wild as the Emerald City from The Wizard of Oz, which also came out in 1939. And it also recalls a little bit, and this is just coincidental, in The Voyage of Life, youth. Right? That that's the dream in the future. Where's my Tucson? There it is. The inhabitants of the semiotic phantom of Tucson are the children of the Yalta Downs, 80s that wasn't. They were the heirs to the dream. They were white, blonde, and they probably had blue eyes. They were American. They're all Tom's with. Gibson merely imagines the world Heinlein and Gernsback would have had for us. White, blue-eyed, streamlined, chrome, totalitarian, eugenic, American, male, technophiles, all of them utterly self-satisfied. This is Gibson's inversion of what Gernsback himself claimed was the goal of sci-fi. And this is from our first class. If every man, woman, boy, and girl could be induced to read science fiction right along, there would certainly be a great resulting benefit to the community in that the educational standard of its people would be raised tremendously. Science fiction would make people happier, give them a broader understanding of the world, make them more tolerant. Amazing story, it's 1927. For Gibson, the only way to cure yourself of these semiotic hauntings is like incredibly just lowbrow stuff like pornography, more or less. I believe it's Nazi Love Motel, which I think I'm not going to click on that link. But you may click on that link later. this actually exists. So some things are stranger than science fiction. They're just fact. So the implication being that the technophilic world that Hugo Gernsback imagined and resulted in the Hugo Award, this remarkably phallic award, looks a lot like the V2 rockets that the Germans launched on London during World War II. But the rockets on the covers of the Gernsback Pulse had fallen on London in the dead of night, screaming. This is also the fate of the 1939 World's Fair, which in 1940 was utterly taken apart, every bit of it, and all the metal, all the scrap for it was reconstituted for the World War II effort. So the Gernsback Continuum is a story about the history of a genre. It's about how a past imagination of the future can still haunt the present. It's also a critique of the so-called linearity of the historical timeline. In Gibson, the present is not just haunted by the past, it is also haunted from the sides by the parallel universes of what could have been. It is also about the boundary between science fiction and science fact, about the dangers of science fiction erupting into the real world. And it is also an homage to and an admonition of the golden age of sci-fi. An admonition, something along the lines of, be careful what you wish for. To wrap this up, there's so much more to say about time travel. This is a whole book that is just time travel short stories, not even the long ones. There's time travel in film, there's time travel in physics, general relativity, special relativity. There's time travel as anti-history, which I talked a little bit about today. There's time travel and colonialism, which is a great example of in your anthology. The one called Invaders. Time travel and feminism, and race and time travel and music, art and time travel. We could totally have an entire course about time travel. In fact, I'm starting to work on a syllabus for it. To conclude, and to return to Carl Sagan, perhaps the most effective and inexpensive means of time travel is right in front of you. It's fiction. Science fiction is your best time machine. Thanks, everybody.
We'll, of course, be talking about the rest of your reading for today. and the reading for Thursday, which is light, on Thursday, and we'll address all the questions from today and for Thursday as best we can then. Thank you, Adam. Thank you.
Yeah.